what we are getting into today with our last section of notes on imperialism, annexation, and diplomacy. We're going to talk about the Filipino insurrection. We're going to talk about what is going on in China with the open door policy, and then we're going to talk about the Panama Canal. So kind of jumping around the world and kind of taking this period of imperialism and wrapping it up in a bow. So with what's going on in the Philippines, so the United States acquires the Philippines at the end of the Spanish-American War, and they become a U.S. territory along with Puerto Rico and Guam. The Filipino people were not happy to see us. They were under the belief that if, you know, the United States won the Spanish-American War, then hopefully, you know, maybe they could even get independence, and they could be their own independent nation. The United States has plans for them. The United States did not give the Philippines their independence until 1946. So it's right after the end of World War II is when we gave the Philippines their independence to be their own country. And so what happens after the end of the Spanish-American War and more American troops start showing up, because the United States had designed and had imagined the Philippines was to be a strategic military base for the United States. Because again, they're right there in the heart of the Asian markets and have access to China and Russia and down even into like Indonesia and Australia. And so they were going to be a military base for us. They were going to be a fueling station for us. But when we arrived, over the next 3 years, what's called the Filipino insurrection ensued. Okay? And so if it's the Philippines is in the country, it's PH, but if it's the Filipino people, it's F. But anyway, so the Filipino people are rebelling against the U.S. presence in the Philippines. They are not happy about us being here. And so what the United States does is we deploy around 126,000 troops to the Philippines, which is a ton. That is a ton of troops to deploy to this very small area and this very small group of islands. And so while the United States is dealing with the Filipino insurrection, this occurs for around 3 or 4 years, where the Philippine people are revolting against the United States government and the U.S. presence in the Philippines. The United States committed some pretty terrible atrocities while we were there. When we were there, in an effort to suppress the rebellion, the United States is setting up concentration camps. Now, when you hear that word, concentration camp, and rightfully so, what is the very first thing that comes to mind? The Holocaust, right? And so we have this association with that term, and rightfully so, but what I want you guys to understand is that concentration camps are meant, just the root of that, is meant to concentrate people away from other groups. And so the United States was separating the women and the children away from these guerrilla fighters, these insurgent fighters that were resisting and fighting against the U.S. soldiers in the Philippines. Okay? Now, some horrible things went on in these camps in the Philippines. These women were raped, they were tortured, they were abused. And throughout this whole insurrection of around 3 or 4 years, we've seen estimates anywhere from 50 to 200,000 Filipinos were killed. So this was really, really bad, what was going on here. And so it was really bad what the United States did to the Philippines. But we had this goal that they would be a naval station, they would be a military base, and they would do all these things and serve us, and they were our territory, so we can do with them what we want. And so eventually, the Philippines will know they're no match for the U.S. military, and there's nothing that they can do to really fight back against the U.S. military. And so they eventually concede. And so a man named William Taft, who will eventually go on to be president, this is his first kind of debut as a politician and serving overseas especially. And so William Taft is sent as the U.S. Territorial governor. So his job was to run the Philippines. And while he was there, he did improve their health care, their education systems, their infrastructure. He spent a lot of money and a lot of time on building better infrastructure, roads, bridges, that sort of thing, building better schools, and building better hospitals. But again, there's a pretty large population of U.S. servicemen that were living in the Philippines. So it was not just about, oh, we're going to do all these amazing things for the Filipino people. It was also because we had a pretty significant population of U.S. troops that also lived there. So that's kind of what's going on in the Philippines. And then that insurrection is over around 3 or 4 years later. But there are around 4,300 Americans that were killed, but estimates from 50 to 200,000 Filipinos were killed. Okay? So China. China. So for centuries, we have the Western world, meaning Europe, has traded with China, right? So why, what is there in China that is so desirable? Silk. What else? Spices, right? Different types of exotic goods that cannot be bought, artwork, gunpowder, like things that cannot be developed anywhere else in the world, these exotic commodities that can only come out of China. So what starts happening in the late 1800s, the early 1890s, is the first country was Germany. And Germany, and then slowly followed by Britain, France, Japan, and Russia, they develop what are called the spheres of influence in China. Okay? And I'm going to show you guys a map of what these spheres look like, these spheres of influence. And so these are called leaseholds. Okay, leaseholds. And so what these countries did is they worked out an agreement with China to lease very large pieces of property. I'm talking like thousands and thousands and thousands of miles and acres of land in China. And so they would lease these properties and they would lease these plots of land. And anything that was mined or harvested or extracted from those areas, that country reaped the benefits from. They would sell it around the world, they would export it around the world. Now, they are paying China the fee to lease that territory, and China is generating the revenue off of that, and also the tax revenue off of things that are being exported, but that country is generating the revenue off of whatever they extract from that area, okay? So I want you to think about it like if you're leasing a car, right? If you lease a car, you're paying that dealership $300 a month or whatever to lease that car. But while you lease that car, are you not the one that's reaping the benefits of having that car? Yes, you're driving it to work, you're taking it on road trips, but you're also paying the maintenance, right? You're paying for the oil changes and the tire rotations, all that sort of stuff, right? But at the end of the day, that car still belongs to that dealership while you're still reaping the benefits from it. So yes, China is benefiting because they're generating revenue off of the leasehold and the tax revenue, but these other countries are also reaping the benefits because they're generating a lot of income off these commodities that can only be extracted out of China. But here's the problem. Who's left out of that? The United States. And the United States is having a serious case of FOMO. Okay? What is FOMO? They're missing out. And so literally, the United States is like, hold on, hold on, hold on. Like, we're not involved in this. Like, we need one of these. But like, we're going to lose our relationship with China. Oh my God, what are we going to do? And so our Secretary of State, John Hay, sends a memo called the Open Door Note. And he sends the Open Door Note to representatives from all five of those countries and China and says, hey, this is what we're going to do. We're going to have free open trade throughout all of China and all of these spheres of influence, and we can buy anything from anyone when we want. Hope you can get on board. So that is what's known as the Open Door Policy. The Open Door Policy is going to create an open doors in China so that the United States and these other countries could trade equally with each other throughout these spheres of influence. We just didn't want to miss out on what was going on in China, essentially. Okay? But the problem with this is that as more and more Westerners are settling in China, what is going to start happening to Chinese culture? It's going to be changing, right? And China is very similar to Japan in that they very much so believed in, keeping and maintaining and preserving the purity of their culture. And so as more and more countries, Western countries, were settling, and we weren't just going there for trade, we've also got the Anglo-Saxonism thing going with us, and we're trying to spread our religion. And so what started happening was Christian and Catholic churches started getting built in China. And that was not okay for the Chinese people. Let me finish this and I'll be right back, okay? So what happens is Christianity is very much so rejected in China. Still to this day, is not welcome in Chinese culture. It is still today illegal to preach or to practice Christianity in China. And so what starts happening when all these Catholic churches start getting built in China, these nationals are like, oh heck no, this is too much, you're too much, too much. And so this group that the American, well, Americans and foreigners, really foreigners, call were the Boxers. They were this like super strong, intense nationalist group that performed and like practiced all these martial arts. Why they called them the Boxers. But they were called the Righteous Fists. And so what starts happening is these Boxers start waging war on foreigners in China. And they launch these massive attacks. And over a period of about 6 weeks, they killed around 200 to 250 foreigners. And they killed thousands of Chinese that had converted to Christianity, or who were like adopting these Western practices. It was really bad. And so they were sending this very clear message of, you're not welcome here. Your religion, your culture, your languages is not welcome here. So that's what's known as the Boxer Rebellion. It's this rebellion and this killing of a lot of foreigners and Chinese who had converted to Christianity. So that's the Boxer Rebellion that a lot of people talk about and know of. The open door policy was our foreign policy with China for the next 4 years. So what this creates is what is known as favored nation status between the United States and China. So essentially, it was free for us to trade with China, and we could extract and take whatever we want, and we give them a little bit of money, and it was this mutually beneficial relationship. Except the nationals, the Chinese people, would say it's not mutually beneficial because they got a bunch of freaking foreigners that are destroying their culture in their mind. Okay. So now, once the Chinese Revolution happened in the 1950s, all the doors are closed, and they want all the foreigners out, and that's when China went back to this very isolationist, when the revolution happened and China falls to communism in 1950, and they became very North Korea-ish after 1950, very closed off, out, no outside influence. So that's the open door policy. We're going to do a little bit with that here in just a second. Teddy Roosevelt. So now, Teddy Roosevelt was not elected in 1901. He becomes president in 1901 after what happens? McKinley is assassinated like 4 or 5 months into his presidency. Teddy Roosevelt was his vice president. So there's always the question of who is the youngest president we've ever had, right? And everybody always says that it's who? JFK. John F. Kennedy was the youngest elected president of the United States. But Teddy Roosevelt was the youngest president, youngest person to become president in the United States. They were both 42, which was good. It was like 5 months. Okay? So that's it for a trivia question. John F. Kennedy was the youngest elected president, but Teddy Roosevelt was the youngest person to become president. Okay? So Teddy Roosevelt becomes president in 1901, and he finishes out that 1900 term, gets reelected in 1904. And so we talked a lot about Teddy Roosevelt last unit when we talked about his domestic policies, like the Square Deal and the progressive politics and cleaning up the environment and cleaning up politics and culture. But his foreign policy, or what is known as his diplomacy, is what is known as big stick diplomacy. And he always used this phrase, speak softly and carry a big stick. Speak softly and carry a big stick. So what does that mean? softly and carry a big stick. Laura. What do you mean play nice? When do you use the big stick?
You just have to go on your way.
When talks don't work, right? So the goal or the idea behind big stick diplomacy is that, you know, speak softly is to do use diplomacy and use talking and use, you know, the diplomatic relations and the political relations that you have with these countries. But if and when diplomacy isn't working anymore, know you got that big stick to back you up. Right? And what is our big stick at the turn of the 20th century? That big old Navy that we have spent millions of dollars on, right? So speak softly and carry a big stick. So, or as Teddy Roosevelt would explain it, it is the exercise of intelligent forethought and of decisive action sufficiently far in advance of any life crisis. So be on the offensive, not on the defensive. Right? So like know if something's gonna happen. And so that takes us to the Panama Canal. So the Panama Canal was actually, construction began of the Panama Canal by the French. They started digging up the Panama Canal, and they got like 2 or 3 years into it, and it was getting way too expensive, and they were losing, a lot of workers were dying. Like, it's just really deadly work, was building and dredging out all of this land and trying to build this thing. And so the French just threw in the towel and were like, yeah, we're done with it. And so in 1904, the United States kind of picks the torch up for the French because the land in and around the Panama Canal, which is now the country of Panama, Panama was under control of Colombia. Colombia had control of that area, but the Panamanian people wanted to get out from under control of the Colombian government. So we're in the mood for that here recently. And so we're like, sure, we just helped out Cuba, we helped out the Philippines, let's go help out Panama. Oh, we're going to help them build that canal. And oh, we're going to be in control of it. And oh, we're going to make a flip on money. Okay? And so that's essentially what happens. The United States gives Panama and deploys some troops down in Panama to get it out from under control of the Colombian government so that Panama can have its independence. And then from 1904 to 1914, the United States is building the Panama Canal. So it's 10 years to finish, okay? If you guys ever watched videos of the Panama Canal, like how the Panama Canal works, like all its channels and stuff, okay, cool. I'm gonna show you like a time-lapse video of it. It's really cool. Like, the Panama Canal was like nothing the world had ever seen. Like, this canal was such an engineering marvel. We had never seen anything like it. It was like the Hoover Dam, the old Hoover Dam. It was like nothing anyone had ever seen. And so the Panama Canal, you know, the purpose is for shipping, right? Because the thing is, our whole goal of imperialism was to open up these Asian markets. But before this, where is the only place we're trading from to get to Asia? Is the West Coast, right? We can only trade from the West Coast because that's the, I mean, unless you want to go 8,000 miles around to South America. But we've got a ton of cash crops and produce on the East Coast that we can sell to China, but we got to have a way to get there, right? Without going around the entire continent of South America. So the United States builds the Panama Canal, takes 10 years. And so now you can go whoop, right through the Panama Canal and get all the way to China. And that is literally double the amount of stuff that we can sell into these Asian markets. So it was huge for the American economy. It was huge for us to be able to do that, okay? So it's really cool because it, like, it's a series of gates. And so you go in and the water rises and falls, and then you go into the next one, rises and falls. It's super cool. So we're going to watch a video of it, okay? Now, here's the thing. When the United States built the Panama Canal, do you think we said, here you have Panama, it's yours? No. So the United States, from the time it opened in 1914, was in control of the Panama Canal until, you know, can you guess? When we actually gave control of the Panama Canal back to Panama? 1999, the United States finally gave control of Panama Canal back to Panama. So it started with Jimmy Carter in 1977. Jimmy Carter was like, hey, maybe we should like get it to the people of Panama that we have like liberated and all that stuff. And people were mad. Like, when Jimmy Carter was like, hey, we should like, you know, cute little peanut farm from Georgia, was like, hey, we should get Panama Canal back to Panama, or to Panama. And people were ticked. They were like, no, we're like giving them all this control around the world. And so he like started this whole plan that by the year 2000, we were right on time. We would give control of Panama Canal by Panama. So they have been in control of Panama Canal administration or whatever. They've been in control of the canal since 1999. Okay? So they finally get the brevity from it. And the last thing we're going to talk about, I talked about this already, this is kind of a little bit of review. So when we talked about this idea of Pan-Americanism, right? Pan-Americanism and this idea of uniting North and South America and thus working together diplomatically, politically, economically, that was just a reinforcement of which doctrine? The Monroe Doctrine, right? So you've got the Monroe Doctrine and then Pan-Americanism built on this. And then what's next, what comes next is the Roosevelt Corollary. And so this is where Roosevelt is going to propose paying off all of South America's debt to Europe. So if he pays off all their debt to Europe, who are they in debt to? Us. And then who are they going to trade with? Okay. How do Central and South America react to this? They say no thank you, but no thank you. Right? Because our money comes with what? Strings attached to it. Right? So this is overall pretty unsuccessful. Taft continues with this idea of what he called dollar diplomacy. He tried to do the same thing and kind of continue that program, but neither one of these came to fruition. The Latin American governments are like, no, we're good. We've got good relations with Europe. We do and have good trading relations with them. We have good economic and diplomatic relations with them. Basically, we don't need you. We're good. Okay? So that is the Roosevelt Corollary and dollar diplomacy. I'm going to talk about Wilson tomorrow as we head into World War I. So I'm going to come back to him tomorrow after our quiz.